Okay, folks, good evening. All right, I appreciate your patience tonight. All right, so we had the dollar index. We mentioned last week in Friday's weekly review, we were looking for this area of liquidity to be ran out. And I mentioned that if we retrace back up, I'm interested only in this low. Okay, and I wanted to kind of like remove the uncertainty that this low would cause you as a student. And using this one as the minimum level, or the first one to touch on the upside as we retrace, and allowing money management to permit any one of these other lows to be traded to. Obviously, it goes without saying that this is a breaker, okay? But how far do we let it go back? I just gave you that as the context to what I was looking for. Now, I'm going to ask you to take a look at this chart, and with this low in mind, look at what was in place for the price of the dollar index just below that low. Double tops. Okay, double tops. So if we put daily dividers on, you can see that the price action in here, equal highs, just under this low here. Well, they're probably going to reach deeper. So while initially on Friday, this low would have been minimum upside, or the one I would like to see it trade to give me a trade idea, the equal highs in here promotes a deeper look. Okay, in other words, this is enough, yes, initially from Friday, but then we had Monday's trading. Okay, we had the effects of the bank holiday in the U.S. And then we had these equal highs form in the Tuesday London session. So with these equal highs in here, obviously that gives us a great deal of curiosity in terms of how far it can go up. So the high comes in at 96.76. Okay, so 96.76, 10 pips is 96.86, 96.96 is 20, and 97.06 is 30. The high comes in at 96.90 and 5 pip bets. So we have a nice run on liquidity relative to these equal highs. Shooting up with these equal highs here, let's add some detail. So we have this breaker becomes a greater interest because of these equal highs. Watch. Ten pips added to those equal highs. Right there. I'll change a little bit so you can see the color. So a run above these equal highs right here takes us 10 pips in. Now 10 pips above these equal highs, now that takes us back to these lows here. Now is this a breaker? This low here? Not that we're arguing, I mean, because we're really starting to split hairs. But is this low a breaker? No. Because it's not, hasn't sent it higher than a previous high. This low, all these down closed candles are consecutive. These lows, or down closed candles, all comprise a bearish one single candle. If we were looking at, this is a 15-minute time frame. There's 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's a one-hour chart, or one-hour candle, if time was delineated in the beginning of this interval to this interval. Price being fractal, these consecutive down close candles make one singular order block. Now that down close candle, or series of down close candles prior to the run up clearing the equal highs, that makes this a high probability bearish breaker. Notice we were waiting for something else to blend. Last Friday I said this is what I'm looking for. but we had this form prior to this level being traded to at all. So it brings a greater deal of clarity and builds on the context. So it helps us frame, okay, well, this is 10 pips above. That takes us into these two lows here. We nix this one because it's not a breaker. This one is a breaker. So we're coming up to the bottom of these down close candles. So that bearish breaker, we want the low to the mean threshold. That's where the sensitivity is going to be. IPTA is going to want to seek that. That's the highest probable area for your breaker. Price trades up into that, only goes a pipette or two above, and heavy distribution after clearing the equal highs. Runs down, reaches for the sell side liquidity pool, 10 pips and 20 pips respectively. You can see very, very nice response there, and we've been banging around inside of 10 to 20 pips below this liquidity pool. By itself, this is beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful because it's what we were looking for last Friday. So we had all weekend to digest what was spoken about, what I said was likely to occur. It gives us a lot of, well, depth in our study, because even if you weren't watching it live today, which was interesting, if you go back and just look at the recordings again and then use these charts as models, and obviously add annotations, what's necessary. For instance, in your journal, you want to mark up where the spaces would permit, where it's empty, the things I said about how we wait for Monday's trading. Remember, I like to wait for Monday because Monday gives me context, as you'll see with the euro dollar. So moving on over to euro. Here we have the mess that is fiber. To the uninitiated, it's a mess. So right away, your eye should be jumping to the inefficiencies and how price trades to them, shows a reaction, how price trades below old lows and above old highs, creates real support and resistance, and seeking liquidity. Okay, obviously last week, we said that we were looking for these equal highs as they draw on liquidity for this week. The specifics were it was going to want to run these highs the first half of the week. So we would see bearishness on the dollar index, higher prices on euro dollar and or cable, specifically looking for euro dollar to go up to these here. And be careful with cable because it could hurt you. And we'll talk about cable after we go through fiber. So I'm going to add some detail. We talked about this load being down here. How is a one-shot, one-kill scenario here to here. You guys saw the actual trade details, all that business on Twitter. No need to rehash that. Let's put some details on the chart. All right, so we have a little bit more detail on here. Now, again, I'm sharing with you how my actual personal charts look. This is what my chart looks like in my own system, in my own charts away from this laptop. When I sign on and talk to you guys by way of the internet, it's always through this laptop. I don't ever let my computers come in contact with social media. I don't even open up emails on it. So what I do is I try to transpose everything that I have on my own personal charts into this MT4 chart to show you once in a while, not every day, not every week. Because if I do this, again, like I mentioned last week, if I do all the markup for the charts, I'm doing all the work for you, and you're going to grow accustomed to that and spoiled and lazy. You need to be able to do these things on your own. You want to build your own journal with what has happened and what insights you glean from it, and it helps you formulate a long-term collection of experience. Whether you take the trades or not, whether you trade the market or not, whether you watch it live or not, you always annotate your charts like this. Because it gives you clarity, it gives you depth at the end of the week, and it builds a lot of, well, it fills in a lot of gaps, if you will, in your understanding. Because just because you watch my videos, it's not enough. You need to be in the charts doing this. Okay, so we have a buy side liquidity pool here, which for this week became our weekly liquidity pool. Okay, this is going to be the draw on liquidity. Now, initially, We saw the price banging around on Monday. We have previous day's low, which for previous day's low, that's Monday's low. And because this is all Tuesday's price action. And here's Monday's high. So this is our Power 3 Monday dealing range. Okay, you've seen somebody that's trained with me and has been ejected. He's trying to promote the idea that he's got a method he's created on his own. He's got a watered-down version of what I'm showing you tonight. Okay, I mentioned how to do it last week, and I'm showing you how it's exactly done to the pip with precision. We built in the context that we would see a lower dollar on Friday going into this week. So for the first half of the week, we were bearish dollar. Now, dollar can continue going lower the rest of the week. I don't know that, and I don't really need to know it. All I'm looking for is a one-shot, one-kill scenario. Now, I'm not going to give one-shot, one-kill scenarios for Twitter. Because personally, I think that, you know, what I'm about to say, understand that I'm saying it with the appreciation that they all want to learn, but they don't have the same, well, I guess, motivation and drive that you have. You're here, you're paying for it, you deserve to hear my insights about it and to be able to point to what led to it. When I share my concepts with you guys, it's not meant for you to go on Twitter and share charts with the things I say in the commentaries and make your little notations with FVG for fair value gap. You're actually sharing mentorship content, and that's actually breaching the terms of use. And I've ejected people for doing that. That means you don't get your money back and you don't stay in the group. You're out. So most of my trolls are those individuals because they've asked many times to come back in, and I'm just saying no. Now, maybe they came back and they're repaying all over again to get in here. I don't know that either. But the point is to avoid all that, you don't share on Twitter the things I talk about in the mentorship. We don't talk about our targets unless I prompt you, because now it's past the point where it's no longer useful to the public outside of our circle. Then and only then I'm asking you for your learning and for your experience to consider what I've said prior. But I don't want folks sharing. I know what you're thinking. You want me to see that you're doing it and I'm going to give you a public high five. I don't do that, because if I draw attention to you doing well in your markups, everyone's going to follow you on Twitter because they know you're going to leak the content. And because you may be leaking content, and I've warned you at the beginning and you signed an agreement, and I'm telling you now, this is your shot across the bow, you will be ejected from the mentorship. Okay, so I just mentioned that because I'm on the verge of knocking out like six people doing it. So please, I don't like doing it. I don't like being the bad guy, but you knew this going in, so just don't do that. So we have the Monday's range here with the intent that the week for the first half will be bullish euro dollar, or should be bullish euro dollar. We have the weekly run here. This was the draw on liquidity we were looking for going into the latter portions of last week. We saw that dip down into it, beautiful, to the pip, almost only off by like one pip better two. Our attention was transferred to the buy side liquidity pool above these equal highs and Monday's trading range. Okay, take a second and imagine this chart not being a 15-minute time frame for the entire day. But imagine this vertical line and this vertical line making up the Asian range. Okay, so the hours that comprise the Asian range, we generally see a consolidation. When it's bullish, we want to see it drop down below the Asian range, pick up some orders, run some stops, and then shoot higher. Maybe find some support at the Asian range high, and then continuously move higher. What I just explained to you is the Power 3 concept for intraday trading applied to the weekly range. So we have the Monday range with a bullish stance. In other words, we expect the euro dollar to trade higher. We use the opening price that I showed you last week. Same thing. I'm not changing anything around. I'm not tinkering with anything. The opening price. So if we're buying, we want to be a buyer. The ideal scenario is you want to be buying at that opening price or below it. Or if you're above it, you want to get as close as you can to it. As price drops down initially, this drop down comes in and fills in a little inefficiency here, then rallies back up. And it's creating a consolidation day. The very next day, we see a little bit of a run here. I was trying to go in to do both sides of the marketplace just to fancy dance around, more or less showing off on Twitter. And again, that side of me is not what I want you to focus on. Always try to keep your attention on what is in the mentorship, because I have fun on Twitter. It's my playground. So here, when we're in the mentorship, it's all business, and I want you to really focus on your learning. No ego, none of that stuff here. But the run up here above this high for a buy stop liquidity run filled in a liquidity void. This rally up, I thought that we could have seen it go up above here. I was giving that as a possible scenario, but I had built in contingencies, obviously, as you saw today. I wanted to take a portion off. That way, if I did, I had some of the move on the Judas swing. And I mentioned on there that we could probably be making the high of the day. And it slammed down, taking out the liquidity pool here. I didn't think that we would get this run here. I was expecting this to happen on Wednesday, but we got it today. So you see where I covered on my Twitter example for the exits. If you look at the take profit, I'm hiding this area here because the take profit is significantly lower. So when I do all these Twitter trades, there's a lot of folks out there that are trying to deconstruct it and reverse engineer everything I'm doing. And I'm just doing everything I can to put chaff in the air so they can't see it. So you see what I executed on. I did partials all in here as it was dropping down because I'm closing in this buy side inefficiency, sell side imbalance. That's what this BSI is, okay? BISI. This is a liquidity void, but specifically buy side imbalance. That means it's all buying, all up closed candles, all pulled out, stretched out thin, and sell side inefficiency. That means there's not enough selling in this range between this low and this high. We also have a down closed candle here, which is a bullish order block. Price trades down, closes in the sell side imbalance. So we had buy side here, then we offered sell side. Look at how fast it trades down into that, because it was filling in all of the imbalance that it didn't offer enough selling between these two price points. So we had this real quick run down, perfectly closing in the inefficiency. Once that inefficiency is closed in, I turned everybody's attention off on public. Now you all know from last week that this is the area I said that we would trade to for the week. So please remember that. I'm actually controlling the public's perception of what I'm trying to draw their attention to and what I'm trying to hide from them. Okay? I'm intentionally trying to hide mentorship from public. I'm doing that on purpose because they don't pay for it like you do. So I hate to sound like that, but it's the truth. So nonetheless, there's a lot of freeloaders, and some of them are really disrespectful and ignorant. And if you don't give them everything for free, you know, you're garbage in their eyes. So I'm not obligated to anybody except for you guys. So nonetheless, the BISI, the void in here, once it was closed in, we had a rally up. Look how dynamic this run is. You don't think they were interested to get up here? We talked about this last Friday, okay? Now, I got a ton of emails from people that just signed up, and this is like their first month. And they're blown away by this because they've looked at several of the recent market analysis and the things that they're seeing. And one guy asked me, did I really record this? And is it the same video everyone else is seeing? So I would appreciate it if you would, a couple of you, not everybody has to do this, obviously, but just a couple of you, if you just tweet a simple message that Brian, these messages or videos rather, are the same and they don't change. I don't go back and edit them. I don't do anything like that at all. Everything is delivered exactly the way it is now, just like this video. This video will have all this extra crap in it, me running off at the mouth, but I know what it feels like to be here for the first time. And you think that all this stuff's been edited after the fact, and it's not. It's all as it happens. Okay, so yeah, I think it's funny and it's neat, and I'm thankful because I take it as a compliment. But nonetheless, no, I don't go back and change anything. I don't go back and monkey around with any of that stuff. And the proof of it is, if you go back and look at the 2016-2017 videos where I did live sessions, there's a lot of goof ups. I'll say things wrong. I could have went back here and changed all that stuff. None of that stuff's been edited. I don't have the time for that. So it is what it is. Either I'm right or I'm going to be wrong, and I'm okay with being wrong because I'm right more times. So, so we have a weekly liquidity pool here we were aiming for this week. We had the run outside of Monday's range during a potentially bullish week. Now, this drop down below Monday's low, previous day's low, we're seeking liquidity below here and below here, and obviously, you know, Monday's low. How far can it drop down? Well, here we have 20 pips. 20 pips comes down, hits the order block, and closes in the sell side imbalance. So all of the sell side liquidity has been absorbed. They used all of those willing bodies to sell. All the sell side, in other words, the people that were long down here, they thought they were smart. They had their stop loss trailed here, or maybe they trailed it here, or maybe they trailed it here. Okay, or the ones that went long down here, these long holders, they have a stop loss rate below here. So there's a large pool of liquidity or a collection of sellers in the form of protecting long positions. They use that liquidity when this sudden run down like that, they're rushing down there to get them before they close their position out and remove the potential counterparties that would be allowing them to be a buyer. Those sell stops are sell orders. They're market orders to sell at the market. Why would they want to go down there and hit those? Because they want to accumulate the opposite side of that trade. So every seller has to have a buyer. Every buyer has to have a seller. So they're pairing the orders that all these sell side liquidity pools are being ran out to send off rush of buying counterparty. They want to be a buyer, but they have to have a pool of willing sellers. Well, there you go. They run down, they hit it, stop on a dime, and then once it's done, they do not stay around there long. They get out of Dodge quick. Boom, they send it up. Where are they going to attack? Daily high, previous day's high, and then bingo, the money shot. Equal highs, previous week high. There's our weekly liquidity pool. That's the draw on liquidity. This low to running above these equal highs, not all the way up here, just running above these equal highs, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, or 30 pips, however you want to scale it, you can do your partials, you want to get out at this level. You want to take something off there, and then take partials above it in grades of 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, and 30. Now, wait a minute, Michael, you said it's 10, 20, and 30. Right, but you're not limited to that. What keeps you from making a model that says, oh, I'm going to take partials at 5 and 15 and 25? Nothing. That's actually a really good take profit scenario or protocol. It may be you never want to take profits beyond 20 pips above an old high. You want to be out at 10 and you don't care. That's about how I do it. When you start moving size, that means your positions are really, really large. You really want to start thinking like that. Because the liquidity issue, you don't really want to expect your full position if it's large, especially if you're running a fund or something like that. You don't want to have the problem of having liquidity issues when you're trying to exit. You want to be exiting as that train's rolling into the station. Okay, so that's the theory on, you know, low-hanging fruit, why we want to be exiting before our ultimate target. So wherever terminus is on your trade, you want to be getting out before that. And it doesn't feel right because you're like, well, my target is this. If my target's 100 and I'm long from 50, why should I get out at 85? Why should I get out at 90? Maybe I should hold it until 95 or 100. Maybe it go to 105 or 110. Yeah, it might. It might do that. Or it could go up to 85 and then retrace all the way down to 60. And are you willing to sit through that? I don't like to do that. So that's why we take partials. That's why we teach it, because certain levels may be defended and the bank's going to do what the bank's going to do. I don't always know what the scenario is going to be to the pip days before, but I'm giving you the models that I use to help formulate a pretty good consistency on how to anticipate it. And then when I get more details in price action, it helps me formulate an idea or a trade to frame. So beautiful delivery of the euro dollar, building a model based on the draw on liquidity. Now, the new people are going to say, well, wait a minute, Michael, you bought here. Yeah, you took a little bit of a scalp here. You got stopped out, but then you went short. How'd you get in there? All I was doing was working inside of the Judas swing. I'm hiding everything I'm teaching you here. Trust me when I tell you, if you look at all the examples over time, you're going to see what I'm doing. But everyone in the mentorship knew that this is where I said the market was going to go for the euro dollar. So everything I'm doing that's going against that, it's just a scalp. That's all it is. So I looked at this equal low here. I knew there was a liquidity pool there. And I wanted to see that as a run. Notice that in the Twitter, I only had that little box right below here. Yes, I exited down here, but this is where I had the public's eye because I want them looking here. They're not going to go through their charts and see this, and then matching it up with that. They're not doing that. Trust me, they're not doing it. But if I see students sharing their charts like this, they're going to start figuring it out, and all you're doing is letting people piggyback on your effort. It may be good intentions that you want to see, your instructor tell you're doing good. You don't need that. You don't even want me telling you things like that. Your report card, your scorecard, if you will, is going to be on your executions. Believe me, you'll know you're doing it right. You're not going to need me to tell you you're doing it right. Trust me, it'll be obvious. So we have Power 3 Monday's dealing range acting as the Asian range. That's the reason why I covered down here. And no, I'm not participating in public display of one shot, one kill, because this would have been an obvious markup for people to figure out what I did there, because it was too clear, too obvious. So I keep that hidden. Let everybody else think that, yeah, he did all this, but he missed this. Good. I want them to think just that very thing, because I already told you Friday that this is where we're going to go to. Okay. Again, this is about you doing it and learning from it. I already know how to do it. So if we go over to cable, and we'll come back to euro dollar in a moment, but here we have cable. I don't want to spend too much time on this one because I mentioned this one. If you're not careful, it will hurt you. Okay. Today we saw an explosion on the upside. If any of you were trying to sell short on this one, I didn't tell you to do that. You know damn well that I didn't tell you to do that. So I got a couple emails from people saying, I shorted cable. Man, this thing rocketed against me. Help me. Well, the help is listen to me. I told you, if you're going to do anything with this, deleverage. Also, be careful shorting it because they want to send this thing higher. And we saw a beautiful explosion today. Now, if we look at the notes on here, I have most of it from last week's annotations. Here's last week's high. And we were consolidating. I mentioned in Friday's recording that we would probably see euro dollar consolidate during the first half of the week. We got to consolidation on Monday. We got it starting on Tuesday. And I said that on Twitter, I said, this is some odd market structure. I mean, it was really weird. I would have rather seen it come down and take out these lows here. That would have been an ideal scenario for a long. But again, being kind of weird, that's the best way I can just say it. It didn't feel right. I knew it was trouble. Okay, I didn't want to sell anything like that if I was going to be a trader on cable. I didn't want to sell it, but I wasn't comfortable with wanting to go long with it either. Now, early on in here, we'll look in here and look at this order block. We have this down close candle. One of my students gave me this tip. Thank you very, very much. My OCD thanks you immensely. And what I'm talking about is I fiddle with these trend lines a lot to avoid doing this, but I'm rounding it to the 29 big figure, so it still will accomplish what I want it to do. But generally, I monkey around with it. It's always crooked, and I can't stand it. So, you have an order block here. Price trades down, hits that. Consolidates, accumulates, and then rallies away. One more time, drops down. I would have loved to see this thing come down here and take that out. That would have been an immediate. I would be long that. Live funds, long that. Looking for a first profit above previous week's high, which is over here. Let me take this off. So previous week high, crouching right below that, and then pop. That would have been a beautiful little run. Nice little one shot, one kill, perfect scenario. Not a lot of pips, but just enough to be done for the week. Leave a little piece on in case you get some action, and then look at this thing tear off. Now, with the benefit of hindsight, yes, I can say all this, and no, I would not have if I took the trade or was taking cable. Admittedly, I would have missed this move. Now, I hope that comforts you, because I would have. My entry would have been a run below these lows down here, because I would have viewed these as relatively equal, and I would have liked to have seen a deeper retracement here. Now, if you've gone through my free stuff, a lot of my free content was useful, but also had a lot of my pre-understanding of what I needed to do. I took everyone from Baby Pips through the actual steps that I went through of all of my learning, the very things that I learned early on in the 90s, and a lot of things I discarded. But I was going through a social experiment to see if anybody could become ICT Junior going that same route, and nobody has. So it was just more or less an interest for me to do it. It was like a test tube environment. Nobody got it. So we have a catapult pattern here. This is the Sunday gap up, leaving a gap in here. So that small little gap, price comes down, closes it here, and then rallies up, then consolidates, drifts down, and we could just create this perfect square again, much like we had on the dollar index. Okay, so I don't like to see that type of thing. Now, if it's inside of like a central bank dealer's range, if it's in the flout, or if it's in the Asian range, I love it. But I don't like it like this. It's where the whole day is like that, because it creates, well, potentially seek and destroy. So I'd like to see it. If I'm going to be a buyer, I really want to see it come down below an old low. I want to buy up the sell stops. And it didn't give me that scenario here, so I just left it alone. Granted, it blew out and went higher, but this is what I was explaining to you last week and for weeks. Be careful with this thing, because it could really run on you. And if you think that you're not going to be able to control yourself, just don't even touch it. And that's the best advice I could tell you, because you could literally blow your account and more with this kind of pair. Because right now it has it's like a spring. Okay, imagine a spring, a metal spring, being twisted tighter and tighter and tighter. Eventually, this thing's going to be let go. And when it does, it's going to be moving, and it's going to move a lot. And you do not want to be on the wrong side of it. So I'm taking the initiative as an instructor. Please listen to me, because I would hate to get an email or emails from individuals that did not listen to me, traded with live funds, and over-leveraged, and did something silly and foolish, and then hurt themselves financially because they didn't listen to me. Okay, I'm not a financial advisor. I'm not licensed to give you advice, but listen to this advice. Don't trade live funds while you're in the mentorship. There's a lot of things you have to learn, and I'm telling you to avoid certain things because they're going to hurt you. This is one of those things. So, with that said, let's go back and to last week's price action. We'll close this video because it's a little bit long-winded. The lows here on cable, okay? Notice we have a low, which we nailed, consolidation, and then run right back up into the range. This was indicative of it wants to go higher, but it's in a model where it could consolidate, which is what we saw on Monday and in the first half of today. Perfect consolidation. I mean, this is like textbook trading range environment. But I don't like to see that as a I don't like to buy it just below equilibrium. I don't like that. I like to buy it below the lows. Okay, I want to buy it below the lows. If I don't get that, I'm not touching it. Okay, so that's how I miss moves. And guess what? I'm okay with missing those types of moves. I got burned too many times insisting that I try to be a part of it, you know, on a higher end or at equilibrium, because many times it would come down and stop me out. I don't like to lose. I hate losing. I can't stand it because I'm a perfectionist and I'm also a narcissist, obviously. So I want to keep things, you know, on up and up with accuracy and continuity. If I skirt on the rules that I've put in place for myself, I'm inviting substandard performance. And I don't want substandard performance. I want excellence. Even if it's a scalp, I want excellence. I want at the high or very close to the high entries in the unit to the lows or exits to the lows or very close to it. I'm in a realm where I want 5 pips variance from the actual high and the low. That's not what I want to teach to you to expect, because it takes a great deal of time and effort and experience to get to that. And some of you may never, ever, ever, ever get to that level. Some of you may get to that level. But I'm not encouraging you to get to that level. You don't need that. You just need 50 pips a week, be done. If you get that, you've graduated, okay? So look at these lows in here. See these lows? Let's go back to Eurodollar. We'll zoom out a little bit. Maybe not so much. Right here. These equal lows in that lower low. Okay? Go back to the Eurodollar. I mean, from the Eurodollar to the cable. What's this? What's going on in here? All inside this area here. What's going on? It's being accumulated. Why? It fails to go lower on the 15th of February when on the 15th of February Eurodollar was able to go lower. See that? So that coupled with everything else I gave you last Friday in terms of analysis led to me anticipating the slide on the dollar index and the run on its sell side liquidity pool resting below here. So price dropping from up here potentially, and now we know why it went to this level and how you would use these as a protocol or a process of determining where markets should reach for because of the kill zones and also market structure. So we use these equal highs. You know what's going to happen, right? You're going to run above those highs. How high, Michael? How far? 10, 20, and 30. Or 5, 15, 25. So it's not a specific science of only 10, 20, and 30. You can use the 5 levels the same way. 5 pips above the high or below an old low. 15 pips below or above an old turning point. Or 25. They may be your delimiters because it's the same thing, just using smaller versions of that scale of 10, 20, and 30. Okay, it may not go to 30. It could go to 25 or 27. In my mind, that's 30. You know, that's the range because I'm trying to get out ahead of that anyway. But if you really want to get closer to the numbers, 5 pips above an old high, 15 pips above an old high, or 25 pips above an old high. Go back and look at your examples, and you'll see a lot more symmetry in the markets like that, especially if you're seeing the algorithm keying off of most of the turning points. If they're on fives, well, you got it figured out now. You calibrate your levels and your targets to a 5 level because that's what it's been operating on. If you start seeing the turning points generally in the last 3 days or so turning on the 0 levels, well, then that's what you use. You want to see your sweeps go to the 0 levels. But as a general rule of thumb, you want to go with one camp, either the fives or the zeros, or in other words, the tens, and just stick with that model. Try not to tinker with it too much. you can study both sides and also where the algorithm is seeking right now, but always err on exiting early. You want the low-hanging fruit exit theory. You don't want to be in there trying to get the actual high so you can tweet it and talk about how you're killing it. Okay, you're killing it when you consistently take out the lion's portion of the move. Hide what you're doing, because I'm telling you something right now. Write this down in your book. You don't have your pen in your hand? You don't have your pencil in your hand right now. You're listening to this video right now, and you don't have a pencil in your hand? You're doing it wrong. If you do not write this down in your book, you're going to wonder why the broker is going to screw with you. If you do not hide what you're doing in your exits and your entries, if you try to get in at the absolute best prices, they are going to slip you. They're going to let your orders just not get executed. The spread won't open up wide enough for you, and the market will turn on you, and you'll see your trades erode, and open profits will reduce. And maybe sometimes they'll go against you and turn into a loss. Don't believe me? Trust me. You're going to find out the hard way. So when I'm teaching you the low-hanging fruit exit theory, it's because I've seen this happen in my own trading. When you start pushing size in the marketplace, your broker, you're eating off of his plate. Because, yes, they make a book with their own clients, but those clients agreed to give their money to the broker if they're on the wrong side, just like you do. So if you come in there and you start getting in and out at these major highs and lows and riding them out, how long do you think it's going to be before they take notice of that and start messing with you, because you're going to get frustrated because you didn't get filled or your stop loss didn't get triggered where you thought it should have been, okay, and your stop, it gaps it down just a little bit more and starts eating into you what you thought was going to be the loss. It really is more than that. Or your fills on entries. You'll have your limit orders in, trying to get right in there, the top 2 points or pips, and the spread won't let you in. And then it tears off without you. Frustrating. How long do you think you're going to stay with that broker? Not long. They want you to leave, because if you're that profitable, they want you to leave. So believe me, put that in your book. If you do low-hanging fruit theory on your exits, you won't look like an enigma. You do not want to draw attention to yourself. You don't want your broker thinking you're Roger Rockstar. You don't want that. Okay? You want him to think that you get lucky once in a while and you're going to want to throw some trades. What? Yeah. You need to take foolish trades here and there. Not a lot of leverage, but put something on once in a while just to throw them off. You the dollar index is going up, so foreign currency should be going down. Okay? Go in there at the most inopportune time, okay, and fade that with the euro or the Aussie dollar or whatever. Put the trade on. Put a very, very small, tight stop loss on, like retail do. Okay, they put these really super ridiculous stop losses on. You know, they all think they can trade with 5 pip stop losses on Instagram and such and Facebook. Put a real quick, short stop loss on there, okay, and then try to get like 15 pips out of that. And do it a couple times a week. It sounds foolish. It sounds stupid to you. Like, why do I want to lose money? Trust me when I tell you, you need to camouflage what you're doing. Because once the brokers see what you're doing, they're going to put you in a category of you're a problem for them. Okay, they don't want you that profitable. They don't mind you taking a pound of flesh once in a while. But start taking that kind of money out all the time, they're gonna mess with you. Okay, they just don't want you there. And if they can mess with your executions, miss your orders, your fills don't get filled, you're going to call up the broker. You're going to complain, hey, why didn't this get filled? They're going to say, this is how it goes. Sorry, sometimes the spread is this, the spread is that. And you can't do nothing about it. But what? Pack your bags and leave. That's what they're going to want you to do. And guess what? They'll get it. So do not insist on having the absolute highest high and the lowest low. You don't need that. Now, your analysis may call for it, but you want that pound of flesh in the middle. Be in the middle of the move. Don't worry about those extreme ends. You don't need that. The breakers will help you do all that. You don't need that absolute high. Look at that blue shaded area here at the top. You don't need to be short up here. You knew here was the first line in the sand. You got equal highs. Well, what's going to happen then? It's going to run the high. How far? Well, you got 10, 20, or 30. Or as we learned tonight, it could be 5, 15, or 25. Price runs up, goes into the breaker. Well, you don't want to sell or buy your foreign currency as it hits this very, very high. You don't want to do that. Good grief. You're going to look like something that they're not used to seeing this. Okay, they're not used to it at all. And believe me, they run reports every single day. What accounts are profitable? What accounts are not profitable? They run trend analysis on all of the performance issues that every one of their clients have. Don't believe me? Ask someone that's in the business. So you don't want to stand out. You want to look like the guy that gets lucky once in a while. You got that lucky rabbit's foot. Okay, yeah, the lucky charm, okay, whatever that thing is that you think is lucky, that's what you do. But you have to camouflage what you're doing. Throw a couple trades off here and there. Believe me, do it. If you don't, believe me, you're going to come back and say this in this message. You'll remember this message and say, you know what, ICT told me to do this, okay, and they're screwing with me. As soon as you identify that's what they're doing, don't even question it. Just close your account, roll into another broker. Which broker? I'm not telling you that. I'm not an introducing broker. It's not my business to do that. I'm not licensed to do it. It's not legal for me to tell you to do that. So you have to determine what the best broker is for you. Here, we're all demo, and that's what we train on. We're studying price action. But I just want to give that insight because I've been getting a lot of questions because of the new students coming in. What broker do I recommend? Who should I trade with live funds? That's up to you to decide. The best thing I can tell you is, ask people that are actually trading using live funds with the brokerage firms. And I think if you do the real quick search on Google, you can see who the bigger reputable companies. The longer they've been in business, everyone's going to have a problem. Someone's going to always have complaints about something. They complain about me and I'm calling the highs and lows of the week and daily highs. And it's always something wrong. Okay, so you can't go by that. Go by from the feedback from people that are actually trading with them, and just understand that no broker's perfect. And I don't know which one you should trade with. Okay, you have to determine that. It's your money, and you're going to care more about it than I will. I don't want you to see you lose it, but just know that it's ultimately it's your responsibility should you decide to ever trade with live funds. All right, so I think that's going to be it. No, real quick, I want to toss in here. Where are we at here? Gold. Gold, beautiful run in here at the equilibrium. We've traded through that. We may come back and find some support there. Maybe not. But if we trade back down through it, if we go back below this high here, it's probably done for a little while. At the moment, I would expect it to continuously press up into that buy-side liquidity pool. Really, really nice. Really, really nice run here on gold. This is a lot of money, folks. This move here to here. For gold, that's a nice, nice chunk of change. For each individual contract, if you're a futures contract trader, that's sweet. So, nothing wrong with about $4,000. $4,000 per contract in about a week's time. Not bad. Maine, if you're still in it, attaboy. Until I talk to you next time, wish you good luck and good trading.